Good evening.
I'm Debjit from JSW, presenting a topic on internal auditors of civil and structural work for the IIA Mumbai chapter, Bombay chapter. If you all have any questions, you can write in the chat window and we will take it at the end of the session. I'll just introduce Debjit to you, and we are also very sorry for the issues that we had in connecting. I just introduce Debjit. Debjit has 14 years of work experience into audit and forensics. He has worked with in various industries in steel, power, mine, cement, telecom and FMCG. He has worked with companies like Rajinder Pipes, Global Telesystems, Shaw Wallace, and currently since 2007 he is working with JSW Group. He has been in many companies of JSW Group, including JSW Steel, JSW Energy, Mines, USA, JSW Steel, USA and JSW South Africa. He's worked in, his exposure has been also in various locations in India and abroad. He's a management in import export. He's a common graduate. He's an academic and a semi-qualified accountant professional. Debjit, you can start the presentation.
Yeah, Rita, a little correction. My years of experience is 26, 27.
Okay, sorry about that.
It's okay. Fine.
Yeah.
Thank you for the introduction. And it is an honor to be participating and part of this IIA, this webinar. For me, this is an experience of its kind for the first time. So, welcome you everyone. So, this is a topic. I don't know what is the background of all the participants, but this might be a little drab for the people who are from the commerce background and might be a little interesting from the technical background. So, I would try to make it a little interesting and for all of us. So, I might be detailing a little bit on what the subject is so that it becomes easier for all of you to understand when you take these audits in your assignments. Okay. So, what we are going to discuss today in this today's session is all about field work. So, where the action happens and not precisely into books. Okay. So, we are going to first start. These are the four agenda points why this topic is chosen and what exactly we are going to look into it as an auditor. And one second. What we are going to look at into it as an auditor. Then comes the standards, Indian standards, which are driving this activity. The concepts that we as an auditor need to know, the bare minimum concepts, so that we can do justice to the work that we take up in these areas. And then as an auditor, the last one, but the most important one, where exactly we should focus it. Okay, so there we go. Why this topic is chosen? Because civil and structural jointly, they constitute 20 to 25% of the entire project cost, which includes your equipment. But if we take out equipment, it constitutes maybe 50 or more than that. One second. Then civil. In civil, there are many activities, but we have chosen the top four. That is concreting. Material part, except for the procurement, we really don't have anything to control upon. Procurement and the receipts. So we are concentrating the concreting part, which is only the service part. That constitutes 30% of the civil job. Approximately, these are our approximate figures. Earthwork is around 20 to 25%. Then your shuttering, which is with material, that is 20 to 25%. And steel or the TMT, that is fixing part, not the supply, that is 10 to 15%. Remaining are all small items. So on, in the context of materiality, these were the top line items. with regard to structural, the fabrication, which is service component, the erection, another service component, and last two are alignment and painting. These are the four activities that we get to see in structural. 50% is fabrication cost out of the structural. Erection is around 30 to 35% and balance is alignment and painting. Now, which are the standards for the civil activity which are driving this, which are the basic guidelines like accounting standards? IS 383 coarse and fine aggregates for concrete. Aggregates are nothing but the stone chips. If on a layman's language, if you want to understand, it is like stone chips or gitta. And fine aggregates is nothing but sand. So coarse is your gitta and fine is your sand. So this particular standard talks about which are the material that can be used as aggregates, that is the gitta, or the stone chips, and which can be used as fine, that is the sand. And in what percentage we can use in concrete making. But concrete has got different types of concrete. One is the plain concrete, another is reinforced concrete, another is lean concrete. So what are the percentage we can use in this concrete making? Next standard talks about the design. When a civil structure is erected, the design first come into picture. So why at the designing stage, the designer has to determine what kind of load the structure is going to take, whether it is in an earthquake prone zone, or there would be some shrinkages because of the exposure condition to the sun. If it is mild, the shrinkages might be less. If it is severe or if it is medium, then the shrinkages would be lesser or medium. It would be scaling up and down accordingly. What is the dead load? Dead load means the load of the concrete. And live load is when people or any furniture or fixtures are added onto the structure, that is the live load. So these all are taken into consideration to decide the design requirement of the concrete. Accordingly, which grade of concrete would be required for the structure is decided by the designer. So that is driven by IS 456. Last is the concrete mix. Now, when you make the concrete, there are four or five main ingredients that goes into it. That will come later. But what this particular standard talks about, it talks about the total strength that the different grades of concrete should achieve to comply with the requirement given in 456. Okay. And the measure of that strength is on the 7th day and on the 28th day. Any cement that we use will gain its strength, the maximum strength, the desired strength on the 28th. Okay. And it is not sacrosanct that you have to attain a given strength. There is a range given for every grade of concrete. For example, concrete A. We'll come to the grades, but for the sake of discussion, we are talking about, suppose concrete A grade. There would be a range given in that particular the standard. Okay. Now for highways, beyond this standard for highways, we need to go for IRC 15. So national highways are driven additionally by this standard as well. Now for structural designers or structural engineers, they have to also consider designing requirement of the structures. These are bare structures. These are basically street structures. What is the design requirement? What is the tolerance? What is the tensions? What is the compression which are coming in? For example, there is a crane which is moving on a structure. Crane is a dynamic load. It also has a static load. So what kind of load the structure is going to bear, that is considered in this or decided by following this IS 800. Then 808 IS is talking about which section or which item of the structure a procurer should select or a manufacturer should roll or build in his factory. So this section is, I mean, this standard is deciding that. Okay. Now, some concepts. First of all, whenever any construction activity happens, there is a ground level that is known as original ground level. And that becomes the base for any excavation activity, because build certification for any excavation, this should be the base. So there should be a clear OGL level determined before or available with the team before the excavation starts. Second is borehole and soil report. The soil quality for Mumbai or the sea beds or the sea coastlines and mountain areas will be differing. So the soil report is very important to determine what should be the depth of the columns to withstand the load of the structure. And borehole study is nothing but a sampling. Because suppose we are going to construct multiple structures over a period of 2 acres or 10 acres area. And since it is natural, earth is natural, so there is no homogeneity in the structure or the characteristics of the earth. So it is prudent for any engineer or these experts to draw hole or drill holes down the soil strata of the layers. And this borehole is done either 1 square meter or 2 square meter or 5 square meter area, one after the another in a given sequence. And as you do the boreholing, you get an entire column of soil, which is combination of different soil, different layers of soil. Then those are analyzed, and then the decision is taken what depth and what strength of structure should be getting into in building those infrastructure. Second is concrete. After this is done, we get into a decision of concrete making. What are the grades? The concrete grades start from M10 to M65 and above. It can go up to M90 also. Okay. There are different types of concrete. One is plumb concrete, another is lean concrete, another is PCC, that is plain concrete, another is RCC. Plumb concrete, plumb means bigger stones. It is a mixture of big stones or just smaller than boulders. It is mixed with cement and it is placed below your basic foundations so that it becomes the proper layering is done. It is leveled and then the actual foundation is created. Lean concrete is laid where there is dirt and there is uneven surface. This lean concrete is very, very thin and it is majorly liquid and cement. The part of water content is more than cement. On top of this, the PCC sets in. PCC and RCC, there are grades. For example, lean concrete, it is below M15 is lean concrete. PCC is from N15 to M20. And RCC is 20 above 20. Up to 65 and beyond. Now the design mix. The design mix, when we make this concrete, there are multiple components which gets into it. That is the cement, the sand, the aggregates, the admixture and water. Why this combination is given? Because neither cement nor sand, as we are working with the soil surface or underground, that is the substructure and the superstructure. Superstructure is above the soil and substructure is below the soil. When we put cement, if we do the concreting only with cement, cement cannot withstand the load, different types of load. It is porous, so it is brittle, so it will break. Sand is also similar. Aggregates has the strength to withhold that. Admixture is like an adhesive. It gives the binding, it's like acts as a binder. And water gives in permeability or the workability. because these are all solid ingredients. If you don't put water, it would not be workable and it would not flow and fill up the gaps in between this concrete. If the gaps are there, the air trap will be there, and over a period of time, the rust formation will be there and the concrete would be less durable and it will break. Suppose if any concrete or any building or any structure is supposed to stay for 50 years, 70 years or 100 years, if it is porous because of characteristics of the concrete that has been made, in that case, the life of the or the durability of the concrete will come down. Now, tests. What are the tests that we need to carry out? And these are very, very important tests. But first two are the most important. Test is slump test and compressive strength. Next is your next four are water permeability, rapid chloride and water absorption. These are basically talking about the durability. And slump test, just to make it more interesting, four or five videos we have incorporated in this presentation. Let us see this, what is slump test?
Thank you.
Now, next is the compressive strength. After we get the slum or the concrete right from the batching plant, which produces the concrete, we need to test how much would be the strength of this concrete which are made. So for that, the concrete has to be formed into, poured into a cage, cuboid. Those are known as cagings or the formers. You have to minimum check three such formers, and those are known as cubes. Those cubes are solidified and then put through the water tank. Those are soaked in water tank for 7 to 28 days. First check is done on the 7th day, and the second check is done on the 28th day to see the strength that it has gained, whether it has gained the desired strength as given in the IIA standard. So for checking that, there is a compression done by taking three cubes from the same batch. Three cubes should be taken at a time. Those should be pressed and seen where it breaks. Suppose the concrete grade is 25. So 25 Newton meter is the strength where it should, up to which it should withstand. Beyond that, it can break. But if it goes up to 25, 30, 35, then it is good. But up to which it can go? If it goes very high, then it means that the mix that is being considered or being used, probably the cement or the sand or the aggregate to some extent is being consumed more. If it is lesser in strength, that means we are compromising on some of the other components. So that is a very, very decisive test that has to be done. And it has to be done for every batching or maybe frequently for different batching to see. And there has to be a linkages of what, which concrete goes into which structure. If there is any, because you cannot store the concrete beyond 6 hours, depending on its workability. So if you cannot hold it for more than 6 hours, it has to be put into the structure and it would solidify in 7 days or 28 days. It will gain its desired strength. But subsequently, after you conduct this compressive strength, if you find that particular batch of concrete is not meeting the required strength, then it is of no use. Then the structure becomes weak. So that identification correlation of the batching output vis-a-vis the concrete cubes has to be established. There has to be a control. Next three or four tests are durability test. So this comprehensive stretch is very, very important. Then steel. Steel or TMT rods, as we see, is used only for RCC. That means 25 and above. Which are the steel grades that are getting used? There are only three grades. That is Fe 500D, Fe 550 and 600. And as a thumb rule, we can see that kg of steel per meter cube of concrete, it varies from 100 kg to 180 kg. Why it is so? It is because there are different types of grades of concrete from 25 to 90. And the requirement for the structure is different. So there is a range of steel that is getting consumed per meter cube of concrete. If you go to YouTube, you will find there are various such thumb rules on everything in steel or, this civil and structural. Now aggregate or gitta, the coarse aggregate. Any gitta or stone chips which is sizing beyond 4 0.75 mm is known as aggregate stone chips. What are the sources? This can be natural stone chips, or it can be from the iron making. When we make iron, there is a slag which is as good as boulders. Those, if broken under a control scenario, then you can get similar cuts which are sizing more than 4.5 mm. It can also come out from steel slag. It can come out from recycled aggregate. When you create a new structure, then you have to demolish the old ones. So when you break those, whatever old concretes are broken, these can be recycled. And these all are given in the IIA standards. Then bottom ash. Bottom ash is an output. It is which is coming from the furnace or the boiler of a thermal power unit. These are as good as boulders. So bottom ash also can be used. Now there are divided views in terms of using steel slag. Steel slag, there are views it can be used, there are views it cannot be used for major structures. Road it can be used, but for the important structures it cannot be used. Reason, steel making we use lime. So if the lime content is more than 4%, then in that case it is advisable not to use steel slag. You can reduce the quantum of lime, there are processes, and then you can recycle it as an aggregate. Now there are aggregate grades. This is also very important. Now one more thing I missed out on the types. Now natural aggregates are usually costlier, but these slags from iron and steel industries or the bottom ash, these are all thrown away. This practically zero value item. So if these are replaced with natural or the granite stone chips, then your cost of structure becomes cheaper. And many companies, many RMC manufacturers, they're using this. Even National Highway, whosoever involved in making National Highways, they are also using it. Now aggregate grades. Now there are different shapes and sizes of this aggregate. These are very important to fill up the gaps. And the nature of this, the characteristics of this aggregates. First, how do we get this aggregate? These are big boulders. We first have to move it through jaw crusher. The jaw crusher has got jaws. It cuts those big boulders into small particles. Then further chipping is done. It is in the second cone. Then is the another cone. Then is the VSI grade. VSI grade is the finest one and is the most strongest one. It is cuboid in shape or squarish in shape. It is very hard. Whereas jaw, cone and cone, first stage, second stage and the third stage, they are not that strong. Parallelly, seeing to their strength, we have to see the structuring of those. If the aggregates are flaky like cornflakes, we eat cornflakes. If it is like cornflakes, those are called flaky. If the stone chips are long and the corners are elongated, then if it is flaky or elongated, there are chances of stone chips breaking subsequently. So the desired strength will be compromised. So these are seen by doing a test called sieve test. In the sieve test, we see what percentage of these stone chips are flaky, what percentage of these are elongated, and what percentage of my desired sizes of, and one more thing, size is also important, which is not captured here. You can go for 20 mm size, you can go for 10 mm size, you can go for 18 mm size. So sieve test also captures what percentage of your total supply of aggregate is falling within that percentage limit. If the designer or the consultant says that this percentage has to be 18, this percentage has to be 20, then sieve test will throw up that percentage. Sand or fine aggregates. Sand or fine aggregates are coming out of aggregates or the boulders only. When they are crushed finer, after these aggregates are obtained, Then you get sand. Sand can be sourced from natural sources, river sands, or it can be manufactured sands, which is from boulders. It can be from the same source of iron slag, steel slag, or recycled aggregate. Even the copper making also, we get slags. This is also again coming from the ice standards. So these are all cheap sources as against your natural or the granite sands, which is coming from granite. So it is prudent to use this because these are also equally satisfying the characteristics which is desirable, but not costly. Test, there are multiple tests. We will show you one test called which is got silt content. Now salinity is very important, and silt content, let us see how it works. It is not supposed to be there. Next is shuttering. Shuttering is an important area where we have seen after the concrete is made, we create a wooden structure, and inside that wooden structure, there are iron rods which are known as TMT, and those are caged by stirrups, and within that we pour the concrete. So shuttering is very, very important because it gives a shape to the columns or the beams. If any concrete comes out of the shuttering, the gaps, then there is a wastage. And every concreting requires shuttering. And this is a very high cost item. So shuttering can be carried out by, done by wood, by aluminium, by steel, by fiber. So we will see what are the benefits and the demerits of this. Wooden shuttering, they are less durable. You can conduct maybe max to max 10 to 15 shuttering with wooden. With aluminium, it is very high. Aluminium is lighter. Steel is widely used by almost all the infrastructure companies, big corporates who are doing it. But steel, the demolding, once the shuttering is done, the concrete solidifies, you have to take out the shuttering. For wooden, you have to put oil, and the demolding becomes a little difficult, while in steel it becomes easier. Fiber these days is catching up because it is durable, easy to handle, and it can raise, I mean, go up to different heights. Steel at working at height becomes a little difficult, but the finish is very good. So as in aluminium and fiber, but in wooden, it is sometimes difficult if the surface is not smooth. So let us see what is shuttering.
It is important to align them for verticality so that load is transmitted properly. The column shuttering should be strong enough to take the pressure of fresh concrete and remain in position during concreting. Here are some tips on column shuttering. To hold the concrete shuttering firmly in place with proper alignment, the concrete pad and Now let us get some idea about the structural steels. Any structure can be technological structure or a normal building structure. And technological, whether it is technological structure or building structure, it can have dynamic load, which is varying, and it can have a static load, which is not varying. So this will have an impact. What is the nature of load will decide what the design should be. And any structures are made out of built section, that is inbuilt. We are creating, taking smaller components like angles, channels and beams, those are the sections. And then we are developing those structures in-house by welding. Or we can buy straight away, these are bought out items, and just fixed. The end edges are only fixed by welding. The structure gets erected. What is factor of safety? Now, consultants, they want to play very safe. Suppose today we all are sitting now in some place. That particular slab or the level is supposed to take a load of 500 tons. Now, over a period of 10 years, the structure becomes weak, but the consultant, not the engineer who has made this, they would know how much of loss of strength has happened. So instead of 500 tons, they would consider the current factor of safety to be 400 tons. That is, they would reduce it by 20%. So factor of safety that is considered is 20%. Now, to reinforce or re-strengthen it to build up some other structure on top of it or attach to it with its support, you have to put some additional structural support. So for that also, we need to see what extra factor of safety we need to build in. Some of the consultants, they will consider one as given in standard. Some of them will take 1.1. Some of them will take 1.2, 1.3. Which is the correct? That actually plays an important role, because as the factor of safety goes high, the consumption of material goes high. So as your cost of project. So this is very important. Steel grades. These are three steel grades which currently get used for building structures. That is E250, E350, and E450. Now, what are the difference between these three? 250 is less tensile, that is less stronger compared to 450. If you use higher sections, that is 450, I mean sections made with 450, then the load bearing capacity will be more. But it again, reduce your tonnage of steel that is getting used and the consequential cost of consumables in the form of welding rods or labor. So there has to be a trade-off which one you should use, where there is no movement possible for the structure. So there we can do with 250, but where there are movement, static load and dynamic load both, there we can think of this higher grades. And there has to be a trade-off between the cost and the benefits. So design, as I have said, these are the factors we'll be getting into deciding the designs. Now, whatever structure gets erected or built up, there are two tests. One is physical test and the chemical test. Chemical test is very easy and it is usually not carried out until unless there is a doubt, because these angle channels or beams are all bought out items. Then those are joint and erected. So bought out item means these are all from IIA certified items. So chemical composition is usually not doubted. In case of doubt, they will check it. Now for the physical part of it, one is the ultimate breaking point. That is the ultimate test where the structure can break. And another is the yield point where the structure can get deformed. It will sag. Sometimes we'll see some bridges or some dams or any structure will sag, and after a point of time they will break. So that is the point of breaking, and another is the point of yielding, that is the deformation. These are tests which are carried out. Similar like your compressive strength, where the brick or the cubes break. Now, since we have fairly got an understanding of what are the components, what we need to check, I mean, what are the importance of this, so let us get into now the audit part of it. When we do indenting or RFQs, there are chances of splitting these orders for efficiency issues or for some vested interest. So we need to compare. For example, I'm doing project A. Project A will have various components, water equipment or the water component, utility part, or the main equipment part or the foundation. Now, if I know when I'm conceptualizing the project, at that point in time, I would know which are the main structures we are going to get into it. If I split it as a project team, I will get to know by seeing the scope of those various orders as an auditor. Simultaneously, I can re-verify or cross-verify that doubt by physically checking whether those are being carried out by carried out for similar purposes, and whether the scopes are same, and deliberately those are split into different parties or the same party under different orders. Only the line, the names of the scope a little modified. Now the cost backups and the departmental estimate. This is very important. When we get into an indenting stage or an RFQ floating stage, the department should know, because they are supposed to be the experts. They should know what is my tentative or the detailed cost, not the tentative, the detailed cost of each item which are getting into making this. Most, in many cases, we have seen that these backups or the departmental estimates are not in place. So the negotiation team, they find it difficult or they don't have a base to start the negotiation. And rather, as a company, we don't know what should be the price. If you see, refer to the government practices or many corporates in India and abroad, they have their teams in-house, in-house teams and a handbook which talks about the list of items, the costing, the items that are getting into it in making of that final product. This is a one-time activity majorly, and until and unless it requires any change with years passing by, it does not require too much of detailed analysis. Next is the reasons and the pattern of amendments. You'll get to see, I have project cost of 100 crores. Invariably, over a period of 6 months, it will go for an amendment because there is a cost escalation or a overrun. Why so? If there is a typical pattern happening and wherein the vendors who are involved are similar, or the employee, the planning team or the employee specific is similar, then you will, there is a doubt that these amendments are specifically because of splitting or not conceptualizing the projects at the initial stage properly. Next is RFQ. When you are floating an RFQ, are you very, very open in floating the RFQ? Are you picking up the entire available vendor or the contractor list and floating the RFQ to all of them? Or you are selective? And if you're selective, what is the reason behind it? Is it their capability or some personal bias? That can be checked. So next section of vendor selection is very important. So you can see, if you get in, get deeper, that there would be many vendors. I have seen in my career that there are many vendors with different names, but PAN number becomes safe. So this homework we can do. Customer feedback. We should take what is the customer feedback and what are their current customers. Can they show us any given or the recent orders? We can check the customer base from their from their website and even their TDS details. Okay. Then past performance, their capacity. Sometimes we have seen that the capacity of the vendor is absolutely zero. They are just starting their business, and there are certain patronizing which is happening from inside, because of which they are getting orders, and over a period of time they become bigger. So there is a personal bias, and we don't get to see this, and they are working under different banners or different names. So this needs to be checked. Rate discovery method. What is the rate discovery method? One, as I have said, that there has to be a departmental estimate. Now, departmental estimate might have been done 10 years or 5 years back. Many things have changed in the economic scenario because of many various reasons. So it is better to get into reverse auction or have a rate contract and parallelly refer back to the costing of the department that they have paid. And how exhaustive are those? Based on that, the negotiation should happen. And if it is reverse auction, by definition or the basic structuring of this auction, you will get to see the better pricing for you. Then if there is a price escalation, and if you are providing material and that is factored into it, if there is a back, I mean a downward or upward revision of prices of the materials, then there has to be a clause in it. Then rate clause, rate of the clause might be different for similar work and for different vendors. If there is a preference, same work, under by coining or twisting few words inside the scope, you can give a better rate or a higher rate to your preferred vendor, whereas the other vendor who are genuine, they will get a different rate. So you have to read between the lines of the scope, the major big ticket items, you will see that there are differences. In SAP or in your ERP, you will get to see
that similar scopes have different description. If you get into the details of those specific big ticket items, you will come to see. And if you visit the site parallelly, you will come to know that work is same, but the rates are different, and it is different for different vendors. Now, material procurement, the quality and the quantity. It is about the steel, the cement, the aggregates and sand. Whatever has been ordered, are you getting it? If the aggregate is VSI grade, which is the costliest one, are you getting VSI? Are those getting checked? If you are not checking it, then you are paying for something which you are not getting. Are those matching the quality requirement? If you're ordering for a given cement, are you getting those grades of cement? If you're ordering for a particular steel grade, are you getting those steel grades or are you getting some other steel grades? Sand, similar way, if you're getting saline soil, which is from the sea coast, or you're getting soil, I mean sand from which are not saline, this will make a huge difference between the quality of structures and the money that you are paying. So is there any penal clause for this kind of deviations? And also linking of these supplies. For example, aggregates would be a huge percentage in the design mix when you're making the concrete. Sand would also be so. So how, and those are going to come either in rake or in trucks by road. So how are you going to link those supplies truck to truck? What is your sampling methods? So these linkages and qualities has to be established, because aggregate gets dumped in one or two heaps. Now, when you get material in a project site, everything is in helter-skelter. So, and material issued to one contractor can subsequently be transferred by contractor A to contractor B. Contractor A might be handling project one, and contractor B might be handling project two. If there is inter-transfers without knowledge of the company or us, I mean the users or the project team, in that case, reconciliation becomes an issue after the project is over, or even in case of running bill. So you would see a pattern where the running bill are not reconciled, and we are making, and if those are not certified, and we are making advance payments, payment after payments, which are in advance. And there is a bill which is booked, but or kept in advance and are not certified. So then you can get into these dimensions, whether there are issues like this or not. Then execution, earthwork. This is one of the major components. This is going to talk about, we are going to discuss about the control and the correctness. One second, I think there is some.
You just asked, disconnected. All are connected.
We are automatically disconnected.
You are connected?
Hey, what will disconnect over?
Yeah, hi everybody.
You, we all are there connected?
Yeah, all are connected, na?
Yeah, fine.
No, couple of people here are got disconnected online.
Attendees 52 out of 101. Fine. Now it is about the earthwork. We are going to focus in now about the correctness of the earthwork that is getting certified and the control that are in place. Now, there would be soil. When the excavation work starts, there would be soil of different types. It can be soft, semi-soft or hard rocks. The rates for hard rock, soft rocks and semi-soft soil and rocks will be different. So if there is a connivance, there would be overbilling, so you have to keep a track. How can we track? It is only through weighment. Random weighment you can do. There might be resistance that we cannot weigh, but random weighment can be done for various samples, and you can find out whether there is any difference, what is being transferred or whatever is being certified. Okay, and you can put that practice in place for the user team before the certification is done. And there has to be a weighment slip attached to it, maybe along with the snap, because you don't know which thing is getting weighed. whether it is hard rock or it is soft rock. Aggregates certified as purchased. Why we are using it? By using our boulders, when we excavate, we encounter big boulders. So what we do, we either get it crushed from the nearby crushers or in-house crushers or by any other means or by blasting or whatever. So in that case, we get our aggregate sourcing from our internal excavation work. But sometimes we can show it as aggregate purchased from outside. So there is a big difference. So this is coming for free, except for the royalty portion, which we need to pay, because today the rule says that if you take out anything out of your mother earth, there is a royalty which you need to pay. So that portion anyway gets into it. Shifting of excavated soil, and it is used for backfilling. Whenever there is excavation, that after the structure, the substructure means any structure below the ground, after it is done, we have to refill that area, the vacant area, with the soil that has was that was excavated. Remaining soil will be required to be shifted. But what happens, because there is dearth of place in the project site, it is said by the user team or the project team that we need to shift, or we have shifted. So what is the control over that? If you are able to establish that control, you might come across this kind of scenario that it is directly used for backfilling, but it is getting shown as transported out, transported back, and then used for backfilling. So this extra transportation might be for the same purpose. In some cases, you can even come to know that the transporter is the vendor itself, but under a different name. My experience so shows that quantity dismantled in absence of drawing. Whenever you are dismantling everything, anything before you are erecting new structures, you need to have some rough estimate of any dismantled quantity, dismantled structures, because they might say that it is not available, it is not possible. Every structure, when it is in place, there would be a drawing, and drawing helps you to get the dimensions, and dimensions finally to the quantum. Okay. Shuttering. Now, shuttering, as we have seen in the video, shuttering, it requires multiple items. So what is a shuttering quantity that needs to be considered for your concreting work? Now, shuttering is basically, as a thumb rule, it is 2.5 or 4 times of the plinth area, that is the base area, on which those rods are, the TMTs are erected, or 6 times of your concrete. Now, this is not a straight thumb rule, because when you do shuttering, shuttering is there for 24 hours. So today, suppose my batching plant or the concrete mixture which is producing the concrete is able to produce only 50 meter cube. That 50 meter cube will be used for concreting, and that has to be concreted within a given time, otherwise the concrete will solidify. So in a day, if my batching plant capacity is only 50 meter cube or 100 meter cube, within 24 hours, max to max, within 48 hours or 72 hours on a very, very outer side, is my total. That means 50 into 3, that is 150 meter cube is my total cement, multiplied by 2.4 is my shuttering quantity, not the total concrete quantity of the project. Now, these shuttering, which was erected, will get dismantled or demolded and taken out after 24 days. So it is a cycle. So you can keep some buffer, but not for the entire. Suppose your total project requires 50,000 meter cube of concreting. Does it mean 50,000 into 2.4? No. So this is another important point. And as a corollary to this, you can also see if the quantum is derived, whether it is beneficial to go for a steel shuttering or a, which is durable, maybe it can withstand even up to 40 to 80 shuttering requirements, vis-a-vis the wood where it is only giving only 10 to 15. Okay, so this is a trade-off that you have to see. Now the cost of shuttering, that for example wood, because of its durability, it might appear to be cheaper, but because of its durability, the ultimate cost goes high. Because compared to steel, which is probably 4 times or 5 times higher durable than, more durable than your wood, the final costing would work out to be cheaper. So would be for aluminium, so would be for your fibers. So that has to be seen scenario to scenario. Certification of shuttering as wood shuttering. So there might be a case, because we are not, as an auditors, we don't see. So if there are some bias or there are some connivance or personal interest, wooden shuttering or the cheaper shuttering might be replaced by costlier shuttering while certifying the bills. Okay. Concreting. Concreting quality and testing, which we have anyway said in the earlier slides, what that we are going to see. This is very important. There are registers which are maintained by the quality team of the concrete lab, or you can say it concrete lab or whatever, concrete making lab. So these tests are carried out there periodically, and the noting is kept for all those. If those are not kept, you never know for which batch, what was the strength derived, and where exactly it has been put into the structure. So there has to be a structure by structure linkage, and strength backward linkage, and the quality of the concrete and sand, everything has to be in place so that there is a perfect correlation from end to end. Otherwise, there would be a total out of control situation going forward if there is a collapse. Possible optimization of design mix. It can happen because designer or the consultant, they have their own interest also, and they can might not always have own interest. They might play safe also. The cost of safety for the designer or the consultant is a cost to me. Suppose I can do a concrete with 30 kg of cement, but the designer tells me do it with 60 kg of cement. Okay, in that case, you need to get it checked. What is the prevailing practice of similar kind of grades, whether it is M25, M40, what is the design mix for your respective locations or nearby companies or your peer companies or whatever. So it is easier, and it does not majorly varies from location to location. People say that it varies because of the water, it varies because of the sand, it varies because of the aggregate, but it does not vary drastically. There can be variation of 10, maximum 20%, not beyond that. But I have come across situations where the differences are very high. It can, it has gone up to even double. This is one important thing in bullet C, yield analysis. It is usually not done. It is fait accompli. We assume if the concrete batching plant, which is producing the concrete by mixing your stone, chip, sand, water, everything, and creating the concrete, we assume that the yield is 100%, because I have got a design from the consultant that I will get a concrete of my desired proportion, desired strength, if I mix 500 kg of cement, 1.2 tons of stone chips, and 1.8 tons of sand, and given quantum of water. But who checks that when we get the final concrete from the batching plant, if 1 meter cube of, and the total, sorry, let me go back again, the total of this, all these 4 or 5 items would be, for M30, for example, is 3 tons. 1 meter cube of concrete is 3 tons as per the design. Now, when the concrete comes out, suppose the batching plant size is 6 meter cube. So the 6 meter cube into 3 tons is 18 tons. Is there any measurement which is being done to see what is the yield of this concrete? It is, if 1 meter cube is exactly or really giving you 3 tons, or it is below. If it is below, this will directly impact your quantity that is getting built. Means the service quantity that is getting built. I have given laid concrete of 500 meter cube. But actual yield from the batching plant, even after following the design mix, is coming only 10% lesser or 20% lesser than that. So there is a compromise in the billing figure. Okay. Optimization of cost of input. So cement, nowadays, earlier we used to use OPC, which is nothing but a pure cement. Currently we are using PSC, which is nothing but a combination of slag and pure cement. Some this RMC construct companies and many infrastructure companies or even corporates, they're using even adding fly ash to PSC or even OPC beyond the cement that they are procuring to reduce the cost, and there is no compromise on the structure. So that can be also explored. Aggregates and sand, natural, if can be replaced by these things. Slag, similar way. But one thing, when you are replacing, thinking of replacing or putting for these observations to the audit, aggregates and sand, sand which are to be replaced by natural ones, their IIA standard talks about certain percentage depending on the nature of concrete. For example, for PCC and lean concrete, sand can be replaced 100%. For RCC, only 25% is allowed. So that has to be seen, how much percentage can be replaced. Otherwise, we'll be compromising on the strength of the concrete. But this much is also going to fetch you benefits in terms of cost. Then batching plant. This has got a linkage with your aggregates as well as your costing. Suppose you have told the aggregate supplier that I want VSI grade, which is the costliest grade and the best grade. You are paying for that costliest grade and the other grades are cheaper. Now there is no testing happening, so you don't know what exactly is coming. So you can have your own batching plant. Batching plant is very not very costly. Or you can have your own tie-ups with the query, various queries nearby, that you are going to work only for me. This is my total annual requirement. It can go up. There might be spikes up and down, but you are going to supply to me only. I will buy you, or I will fund part of your batching plant cost. I am going to check and I am going to take only VSI material, nothing beyond that. Structural design validation in-house is very important, and third party is also very important. Why? Because of factor of safety. This factor of safety, it can be considered twice. Because if I consider current building is supposed is able to withstand a given load X, but if I reduce as a designer, that is not going to take a load of X, it is going to take load X minus 20%. Then this is a factor of safety as a consultant I am building in. So if I reduce my factor of safety, load bearing capacity, to make it more stronger for erecting the structure which is required, I will have to re-strengthen him. So for doing so, I have to put in more steel plus the new structure. Second, where it can get doubled, when the new structure is coming adjoining to that or connected to that, that is an additional load. There also I am putting more factor of safety that gets doubled or duplicated. Now there is another dimension. There are many consultants. Some consultant will, if you see, will give a consider a factor of safety of 1. Someone will take 1.1. Someone will even go further high. So what is that exact factor of safety required for a given type of structure? That can be validated by in-house team. There are softwares available, or can be done by independent third party. If you have technical team, they can also vouch for it, the correctness of validation that has been done. Selection of members. Now members are rolled, either we bought out or built up. Now there is a cost comparison. If you are buying it, the cost is the labor cost is saved because you don't have, and the welding cost, the welding rods are saved because you don't have to weld those members and erect your sections, I mean the structures. But if it is built up inside your site, then those cost of consumables and labor, it becomes more labor intensive and consumable intensive. So that cost, if those are factored when you are fixing the rate, and you have to see, and plus the landed cost. So you have to see what is more beneficial to the company, and there are certain sections which is better if it is bought out, and certain sections which are built. That also has to be seen. Compare, this is another dimension where there can be double billing. So what is your structural quantity? Structural quantity is nothing but a function of your total steel quantity that has been certified or consumed. And what is this total steel quantity? It is either bought and built up by fabrication inside, or those are straight away just bought in and erected. So built up section plus rolled section is your total structural quantity, which is certified and consumed. So there has to be a reconciliation available. Otherwise, there would be double billing, which might be possible if there is an overlap. Second, do we have need to have a separate rates for this built and rolled section? Why so? As we have seen, for rolled section, we don't majorly, except for the end points, we don't need these electrodes to weld those, neither the labors to do that job. So these are less labor intensive and less consumable intensive, whereas the built-in sections are reverse. So there has to be a separate rate for these two sections as well. Now the question is, it can so happen, if you have to be a little vigilant, and by comparing the previous point you can find out if there is any overlap. If built out sections, which is more costlier usually than the rolled section, it can be vice versa also. You have to see that in a particular case which is being preferred. I can order for built section, or sorry, rolled section, which is little cheaper, and I will certify as built section. That will get compared when you are comparing with the total steel quantity, that is a breakup of built and rolled section. Okay, this is very important. Next, your cost and strength optimization of the grades. As I have already told, which section, I mean which grade you should use. If you are using high strength grade, then the quantum of steel will come down, and in structural it is paid based on tonnage. If your quantum of steel is lesser because you are using high strength or high tensile steel, then your cost of metal or labor will come down. So there has to be a trade-off or a comparison which has to be seen or checked or done, which is available in the system. But nowhere it should be compromised with the strength or the desired strength that is required as per the structure. Deviation percentage in actual as per the design section. You'll get to see that somewhere, I mean, it is not about only the section, it is about the width and the dimensions or the thickness of the sections. Suppose the designer says that you have to use 2 mm, or the actual requirement as per design has come 2 mm or 3 mm, whereas actually it is getting used, which is double or maybe triple the size. So if it is thicker, the cost is also going, even the certification is also getting affected. So whether it is happening for a given site, given engineer or a given vendor, that pattern can be seen. Then scrap norms versus actual use of available software to reduce visible losses. There are certain softwares which are available to work out what is the norms, what is my actual. Red difference for similar work and terrains. Same work will have similar rates for similar terrains. Then you have to see the justification for those. Certification of dismantled quantity in the absence of drawing. Similar, certain things which are dismantled, if this can be used, and what is the quantity that is getting certified, that is very important to correlate with the drawings. This is with regard to project closure. Physical verification of the activity, it cannot be at the end of the project. It is not the end of the project, but it has to be simultaneous and real time to the extent possible. If not by auditors always, at least by the user team or the project team. The quantity reconciliation for free issue, if any, that is being given. The settlement, it has to be on a concurrent basis or a regular basis. If accumulation happens, then it becomes difficult. And once the project closure happens, there has to be an as-built drawing which has been certified, based on which the capitalization happens.
The as-built drawing should be available with you, and the handover of site, as well as the residual items, which is a free issue item from the contract, has to be taken. This is what all I had to tell you. I mean, I have
questions.
Few questions, anyone? Or you can send those offline. My contact numbers are also available.
Yeah, if anybody has any questions, you all can type in the question window, which Debjit and I can see it. No, there are no questions, looks like. This either says
I was not able to make them understand, or they have understood it fully.
See, if you were not able to make them understand, then they would not have been sitting here for 1.5 hours at one place.
Sorry?
They stay all the
I can see only one drop out.
They're logged in, they haven't exited out of the whole thing.
Yes.
So there are some questions. Debjit, can you see the questions, or you want me to read the questions?
I cannot ignite sharing chat. Let me open the chat.
So if you go to questions, click on that and you'll see the list of questions that have come in.
Where's the question? I cannot see the question.
Can I say the questions otherwise?
Yes, please.
The first question is, will the PPT be shared by the IIA?
That is, IIA has to, yes, I am okay with it.
Okay, so you can share with Kritika and she'll share with the people who want it.
Yeah.
The next question is, what is the right time, percentage of completion, when we should do the internal audit?
It has to be simultaneous. Maybe 20% if it is completed, or 30%. There has to be considerable amount of work that has been done, but it is in stages, because in civil activity or structural activity, there are various sub activity involved, which is the major activity. For example, in one of the project site, there might be excavation, in which might be 20% over. So you can do that activity or the auditing there. But whereas in structural, it at a 40% stage. So maybe a little delayed. So we can start there and use our resources more. Then again, you have to see what is the value and the volume involved. But there has to be minimum 20 to 30% work. And before start off, wherever we need to focus for the before start off review, there has to be before the start off.
Okay, the next. Should we go to the next question?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, the next question is, do we have any SOP which are applicable to this industry for performing?
Readily it is not. But I feel if you consider this presentation, that will give you good insight, because this I have documented out of my experience of so many years. There is no SOP as such. There are SOPs, but if you apply my SOP for some other verticals or some other industry, I don't know how. And because it is to be, SOP is practice driven. It is company specific. It has to be tweaked. That also is there, but it is in a sporadic form for various activities.
Okay.
That is not available for sharing because it is company specific.
Correct.
Yeah.
The next question is, for performing sensitivity analysis for risk assessment, where should we take the base?
Where?
For performing sensitivity analysis for risk assessment, what should be taken as a base?
Sensitivity analysis of these items.
Risk assessment, she's saying.
For risk assessment.
Can you repeat the question once more? Let me get it properly.
Sure. For performing sensitivity analysis for risk assessment,
yes,
what should we take as a base?
Okay, whether it is high, medium, or low. Is it so?
Sensitivity analysis.
It is high, medium, low. So it is, if it is that, what I am understanding, then in that case, it is the materiality of the item that is being considered or reviewed that will decide what is the sensitivity. And it is not the value. Value, when I'm telling, it is not the financial value, but the intrinsic value of the structure. Suppose it is being built in an area where your main plant or the equipment is resting. If that collapses,
safety purpose
and everything, the business comes to a halt. See, it is also hitting your reputation. It is your operation. Everything triggers.
Much higher than the financial.
So, and that's why this topic is very, very serious topic, and it is material topic. And what I have tried to capture is only the material areas. Anything more?
Rita, are you
there? Can you please explain a bit more about selection of member rolled versus built up?
Okay, rolled versus built. Coming in, elaborate more about rolled versus built. Hello? Hello?
Will you pardon the question, Rita?
Hello?
Can you please explain a bit more about selection of member rolled versus built up?
Okay.
This is more details.
Rolled versus built up. When you are rolling, means roll section means which are straight away bought out. For bought out section, the additional cost, what apart from the material cost, is your landed cost or the freight cost. And subsequent to getting that in the factory or the project site, it is that only activity which remains is the erection, the final erection. Yeah. Next is, comparison to that is your my built up section, where I'm getting the small pieces and I'm welding those and getting into that roll section stage. Thereafter erecting, starting the final finish. So the second section, the built up section, which is getting prepared or built up compared to your, suppose I give you one thing, one example. I am buying a laptop straight away from IBM and I'm getting smaller pieces like the chip, the motherboard and all, and I'm integrating those and coming to the stage of laptop. So this activity of assembling and integrating is labor intensive. So this is similar to your built up section. So when you do built up section, you have to do your, it is more labor intensive, labor compliances, and your welding, the consumables, and more costlier. So this you have to, I mean, it is usually costlier, but on a scenario to scenario to see what kind of members are getting used, what is my freight cost, and then compare and decide which one I should go for. Next, certain members, it is better to buy directly. Certain members, it is better to, get built up in-house, because that also ensures the quality and the requirement, which is specific to various projects. Rita, is it okay? Or he has got some, or the person has got some more questions on this?
Yes, this is okay. There are about 15 more questions. Would you like to take it offline? I can send the questions to you.
15, 1-5.
Yeah, 1-5, correct.
Yeah, it is better. They have my contact number and email ID. It is better if they can email. Contact me or email, send me emails. I will tell them in depth.
What is the email ID? People don't have an email ID.
It is Debjit, 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 1968@gmail.com.
You can share this email ID, Rita, with the participant who had a question. They can email him.
Okay, I think so. I'll just share with people.
And my phone number. It's better they send it through email only.
That's better.
Okay, Rita.
Just one second. Just hold on. I'm just seeing where is your. People have an email ID and phone number, and also they can come to the website to tell the few lines on the webinar. Debjit Pakrashi has done his best to go deep down in the topic of internal audit of civil and structural work and the area of focus during audit. Thanks to all for attending the webinar, and sorry for the initial hiccups that happened. Thanks a lot. We can end the webinar by now.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks to all of you who have attended. As a pleasure from my side as well.
I'll end the webinar now. Thanks, everybody.
Yeah, thanks, Rita.
Bye.
Thanks. Bye.